Officer of the Academy of Science of South Africa, and it is actually a great pleasure to have been asked to be the program director for today and for the committee allowing us to present the, or to host the annual humanities lecture on this very auspicious occasion of the 50-90-100 celebrations. Of course, we've all seen why that is the case, but as the new kid on the block, the Academy, who's just turned 23 years of age, silver lining, so to speak, it is indeed an honor to be recognized as the young one to host this particular occasion. 50 years, the golden era, and that's the anniversary of the Human Sciences Research Council. So well done to you for what has been, I'm sure, an illustrious one, 50 years. The 90th celebration of its predecessor, the National Bureau of Educational and Social Research. Yeah, if you look at anniversaries, what do you celebrate at 90? Well, we say a stone, a diamond, or an emerald. So we are getting much higher in the economic stakes in terms of value. And of course, the 100. Here we celebrate the University of Pretoria, the Humanities Department, celebrating 100 years. So please join me on congratulating the HSRC and the University of Pretoria for these milestone anniversaries. Well, we very rarely consider the importance of humanities in our social structure and, you know, in our veins. And to be presented today with the opportunity to celebrate an annual lecture series on behalf of the Academy with a prestigious guest in that of Professor Crain Soudien, I'm sure we are all going to leave here this evening very, very inspired by what he has to say. But before I get ahead of the game, it is my privilege to welcome a former colleague from Wits University, Professor Kupe, who is now, as I say, the Makulu boss at the university, serving in a role as the Vice Chancellor, to give us a short address. Professor Kupe.
sociology, psychology fields like education and so on should go. How does he do that? He does it through confident intellectuals. Cronje could hold his own. Ideas are in alignment that you should be deeply concerned. So when the University of Pretoria, by the way, when the University of Pretoria is established, it's not established for that strong political agenda which comes to the fore much later on. It's established, really interestingly, with a very strong Presbyterian kind of influence. And in that Presbyterian influence, you have all sorts of ideas that are in the mix in that particular space. But institutions go
Professor Soudien, you talk about the science, the hard science, and the positivism of that time and what we are still grappling with now. But at the same time, there was a lot of religiosity and talk about morality. So what was the role of the Afrikaner church in this positivistic environment? How were these two things married with one another, the facts and faith?
So I'm not capable of giving you a good answer, so I'd rather not. So you have people here moving between those worlds, and you see it in Konya. You will close his argument with a religious statement. And I think we're still needing to explain how that conceptually works. I'm not capable of doing it now. But in this whole thing about existentialism and consciousness, for example, he concludes his analysis about what's going on and says, and I can't say the Afrikaans word, skipper? It means making it, isn't it? The creating. You know, so he talks about this, what's the great creator in Afrikaans? Skipper. Yeah. And he concludes his analysis. This really sophisticated sociologist ends up there. So what I'm saying to you, Nadia, we need an explanation of how that works. And I can't do it. I don't know enough about it.
And sometimes that we don't want to acknowledge, but there is continuity, but there's also change. And so I'm currently working in the government department, and quite frankly, 25 years later, when I look at the government department as an agency of state in terms of dealing with the challenges of today, the faces may have changed. It may have become a little bit darker, but in fact, the manner in which we go about making policy, the manner in which we ponder around the problems of what you call here the degeneration, this particular concern that we have with the degeneration of ourselves as a people, which Afrikaner intellectuals had those days with white Afrikaners, is what we're also currently looking at. And there's a particular framing of it as in terms of black youth, that they have become our fear of what is going to happen to black people, what is going to happen to democracy, because we haven't been able to deal with that crisis, so that the future of democracy is at stake. But we haven't had the privilege of Afrikaner nationalism, of years of white privilege and control and power in order to begin to develop an Afrikaner identity. So when you look at it, what is available, what is left for us? Because in 25 years, it's impossible for a new society to emerge with a sensible identity, a sense of itself. As you talk about the sense of control and order. I mean, here we're sitting in Pretoria, and I must say, I left Pretoria when I first came here because I was scared. I went to Joburg, where I could be hijacked and so forth. But it was that kind of, it's in the place. But anyway, I need to get back. But what I'm saying is that for me, I really enjoy this because I do think that black intellectuals these days should begin to think about the fact that we haven't really established a new understanding of ourselves, a new way of thinking, and I think there's a lot of continuity. And should I thank the Afrikaners? I don't know. Thank you.
So it's interesting to understand the influence where that scholars had on the bureaucracy and the policies of state. So it's, I think it's also would be interesting to link up the schools of thought of these intellectuals with where they studied, where they got these ideas, because I know Louis Botha and Jan Smuts, they were English educated, whereas later they may have had a massive influence on German thinking prior to the war. So, but maybe also comparing it to the competing schools of thought and the competing centers of power, because I'm thinking the influence of the Z.K. Matthews on the black liberalism in Africa and the importance of Fort Hare at the time in the whole revolution happening in Africa in the 60s and 70s. So I'm sure other universities also had that, and the rise of liberalism and the influence for that UCT had and let's say at the time and later on, because of the students that studied under these professors, they became influential in their positions later on. Yeah, that's just my two comments.
Thank you, sir, for the elusive outline of what happened. Just maybe a comment and then a question. Yes, obviously there's been a very interesting social political journey in research in general, in HSRC, particularly in the collaboration between universities, and specifically University of Pretoria and HSRC. But there's also been another kind of evolution, which I would refer to more as a scientific evolution, that took place just as a matter of interest. I started working as a junior researcher at HSRC in 1974, when we were particularly, I worked in the Institute of Communication Research. We conducted a design study on this new threat that was entering South Africa, and that is the impact of television on South African society. Nevertheless, I left in 76 and I returned in 1983 and eventually got involved in what was then referred to as national research programs, a much wider base of collaboration between all the academic institutions and coordinated by the HSRC. I actually occupied the responsibility of coordinator of national research programs. It wasn't a rank, it wasn't a title, it was just the responsibility that was given to me. But when I got there in 1974, and for a long time, the HSRC suffered from, I think, the same malady that most universities still suffer from, and that is extremely high and impenetrable disciplinary and faculty walls. So the institutions or institutes of HSRC were organized along the lines of the disciplines, and they focused on their discipline. It was only with the introduction of collaborative national research programs starting with the longer, and the second one was interrelations by Prof. But as we went further, all of the advising committees were much more representative in terms of a multidisciplinary approach. And so that's almost a parallel evolution that took place that very few people know about. Here's the question I want to ask. Obviously, we need to ask the question, what determines the research agenda Is it the national research needs, or is it the government research needs, and it has been a similar situation then? And my question is just now, is there clarity on what is the basis of the current research agenda?
I think this goes for not only the HSRC, but a whole range of institutions, is this deep, deep awareness in the country of what the basic problems are. And I think that there are very few institutions in the country, and they are doing this in very different kinds of ways, which will not come to an awareness of how critical this question of inequality is. And it comes not because government is saying so. It comes as a result of how I think people working in these fields cannot but acknowledge the weight and the urgency of what these these questions are, and so we do find ourselves now, Gustav, in alignment, if you like, with some of the major intents and purposes of government along these questions, but that is not a manifestation for me of political dependence. It comes as a result of an alignment around simply what the priorities and how those priorities come to us. I think our empirical understanding of the depth of the crisis in the country is what is propelling us.
You've taken us on a journey to contextualize what's happened in the past, and you presented it in a way that contributed to change in a macro environment and the space that we've lived in. And I think for me, what you've done through your presentation is maybe think about how do we move it forward where we are currently, where, as you said, we are living in a very complex world, and I think in the space that we are now, the complexity has got even much, much more dynamic and versatile and more complicated. And us as, you know, the academia need to engage with this, because it does impinge on our social fiber in terms of who we want to be as a society, and the extent at which we, as the gatekeepers of knowledge, contribute to the change that's happening in the macro environment. Yes, sometimes we have a voice in contributing to policy, recommendations for change, etc., but producing the documentation alone is not good enough. We've got to make it move and resonate with the people who have the seats of power. So I think that message came out from your presentation quite strongly, at least for me, in terms of trying to understand to what extent, as Professor Kupe said in his introduction, when we understand the past, that we empower ourselves to handle the present and to project for the future. So thank you very, very much for that, and to the audience for your active participation, for your comments, etc. But before you go, because you were so good at your reading and serving.